morning is found in the book of John, chapter 11, verses 17 through 44. And you can follow along in your two Bibles on page 935. It's a rather long piece of scripture, but it's the story of Mary and Martha and Jesus and the sorrow that all experience over the death of Lazarus. But Jesus comes and brings Lazarus back to life. Here are the words from the book of John. Jesus comforts the sisters. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world." And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and he is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb, and it was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you have always heard me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you have sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." It is Palm Sunday. That day we celebrate and look forward to next week. Many times it's called the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And Passion Week starts with a parade. Crowds cheering, gathering, throwing cloaks on the ground. They're celebrating that their King, their Savior, has arrived. They know that change is coming. The world is moving from what it once was to what it will now be. They celebrate the Savior. Parades are all about moving. Moving from one place to another. Have you ever seen a parade where everyone stands still? Not much of a parade in that, is there? And today's parade is called that triumphal entry. Hosanna shouted by the people. God saves. But I have a question. Did Jesus consider this parade, this entry into Jerusalem, did he consider it triumphal? When he entered Jerusalem that first day, was he entering with a heart full of triumph? I'm not sure that he was. It says in Luke that we read earlier, in verse 41, that as he enters the city, he looks over the city, he sees Jerusalem, and what does Jesus do? He weeps. He weeps for Jerusalem. It's something to keep in mind as we enter into Passion Week, this triumphal entry. Jesus starts the week off weeping. It's not the first time that Jesus weeps, nor is it the only time that Jesus weeps in the Scripture. He does this quite regularly, in fact. In John, the story I just shared of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, we hear that wonderful Scripture, that shortest verse in the Bible. That's a little quiz when we have a biblical quiz. What's the shortest verse in the Bible? Jesus wept, right here in John. Is perhaps the most powerful verse in Scripture as well. So in the Scripture here in John where Jesus wept, why is Jesus weeping? What is your understanding of why Jesus is weeping at that particular time? Why is he crying? Pardon? He's crying for Lazarus. We think that, right? He knows Lazarus is going to be able to come back to life. He's going to bring him back to life, but still he cries. What else is going on here? Why is he weeping?
Because people didn't believe what he foretold.
People didn't believe what he foretold. That is part of why he weeps. He's asked both Mary and Martha, if you follow the Scripture, do you believe? And yet they still have some doubt. So that's part of why he's weeping. How about, pardon? He could be weeping over his future. He knows what he's going to have to face. What about compassion? He sees both Mary and Martha and all the people gathered with them crying, mourning, wailing because Lazarus is dead. I think that one of the big reasons he is weeping in verse 35 is because he is compassionate. He feels what they're feeling. Even though he knows he has the power to bring Lazarus back to life, he feels their sorrow and their suffering. So I think he's weeping out of compassion. See, compassion is a sympathetic concern for the suffering of others. And I think Jesus knows that very well. He experiences compassion regularly. Compassion, in fact, is love expressed. If you love someone and you see that they're suffering and sorrowing and you have compassion, they're struggling in their life, how do you feel? You express it, perhaps with weeping. See, the weeping is an outward visible sign of an inward, unseen feeling. Someone said to me this week, we don't have enough compassion in this world. Love, perhaps, but not compassion. See, compassion is an action word. It causes people to move from where they are to other places. You can't have compassion for someone and sit still and do nothing. It moves things. Compassion moves sorrow to healing. It moves people to caring. And in the Lazarus story and in Jesus' story, we see that compassion moves the stone away from the grave. It moves us from death to true life. Compassion is an action word that has no boundaries. This is what Easter tells us and reminds us to celebrate. I would say in this Lazarus story that even though Jesus is weeping because of compassion for Mary and Martha, that it's not simply just compassion that causes him to cry. He weeps in verse 35, but we move just a couple of verses later to 38, and it says he was once more deeply moved. Once more deeply moved. I believe that his tears were not simply for his love or compassion for Mary and Martha, but I believe his tears were also because he has righteous anger at death and unbelief. John says he is deeply moved in spirit and greatly troubled. Literally, he is outraged and unsettled. He is indignant and disturbed at this concept of death. The same word that is deeply moved being used here in John is a stern warning elsewhere in the New Testament, in Matthew and in Mark. It's even a scolding. It's a serious term. In biblical Greek, it can refer to the snorting of horses. As applied to human beings, it invariably suggests anger, outrage, or emotional indignation. See, it's not quite simple enough to say Jesus was weeping out of compassion and leave it to the effects of empathy or grief or pain. To say that Jesus is deeply moved again when he comes to Lazarus in the tomb means something more. He is shaken up. He is unsettled. He stands face to face with death, very similar to his own death in just a few short days. And he knows what it's going to take to conquer that foe. In this moment, he will take Lazarus back from death's jaws. The next time, he is going to lay down his own life. Part of Jesus' weeping is his righteous anger over death. See, in the book of John, this story of Lazarus and what Jesus has done for him is very interesting where it's placed. We have Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead in chapter 11. Next in chapter 11, we come to a dinner where Mary anoints Jesus. She anoints him out of gratitude for what he has done for Lazarus. And Lazarus is sitting right there in this dinner, alive, with them. And in the very same chapter, the very next section, this is when Jesus enters Jerusalem for this triumphant entry. This passion of Christ this whole week, this compassion, this righteous anger, moves him to enter Jerusalem. Compassion is an action word. And we see him entering Jerusalem in that triumphal entry that I had talked about earlier. And we see in verse 41 that Jesus weeps again. He stands outside or at the beginning of Jerusalem and he looks and it says he's deeply moved and he weeps. Why is Jesus weeping here? Why is he weeping as he enters Jerusalem and all the crowd around him are celebrating the triumphal entry and he is weeping? I think it's because he realizes that Jerusalem has missed the point. He says here in verse 41, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. And then in verse 42, he says this, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace." See, he's been working for 3 years or more, doing miracles, teaching the people, trying to show them his power and his grace and his mercy, with a desire to bring them to peace. But what happens? Just a few short days later, all the people that he taught and shared all that with, they abandoned him. He's trying to bring them peace. He's trying to show them what it is they need to do to find this peace. And they don't get it. And his heart is deeply moved, filled with sorrow. See, he has demonstrated with his own life, his own actions, what compassion can move people to do. See, we are called to use our voices for kindness, our ears for compassion, our hands for charity, our minds for the truth, and our heart for love. This is what he's been teaching, and they just don't get it. So he weeps for Jerusalem. He weeps for humanity. Jesus' compassion for the world, for all of us, moves him through the rest of the week. Moves him through Jerusalem. Moves him to the cross. And as we know, this week, this compassion will move the stone away from the grave, and will move him and us to new life. So Jesus weeps. And in these tears, we see that God does not stand aloof to the pains of our existence. He has moved near to us. He has taken our flesh and our blood upon himself. He has not called us to a humanity that he himself was unwilling to take. We have not been abandoned into a world in which he was unwilling to enter. We suffer no pain that he was unwilling to bear. We have no grief that he is unwilling to carry. Jesus wept. He did not consider himself above our agonies, but emptied himself of privilege by taking our form and being born in our likeness. The very heart of the Christian message is that the happy God who so loved us, so loved our weeping world, that he gave his Son to weep with us all the way to the place of utter forsakenness, that whosoever believes in him will not weep forever, but have everlasting joy. And one day, when he wipes away our every tear, it is not because he is suppressing our sadness. The one who wipes away our tears has shed his own, and he has triumphed. This is the gospel in two short words. Jesus wept, and he has triumphed. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you this day, grateful that you came to us as us, to walk the path that we all must walk, to bear the burdens that we all must burden. Yet in so doing, you have shown us the truth the joy, the hope, the fulfillment of your promise that one day all the tears that we have shed will be wiped away because you have shed them yourself for us and with us. So Lord, I pray that compassion enters our hearts in a deep, vibrant way, that we are moved to weep with the world around us so that they might experience new life and the joy of the resurrection. I ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.